Identification with Christ was what we started. We started, Pastor John, led us into that last week, and I want to continue with that this week, and we will pick up again next week as the Lord leads. Amen. The beauty of this teaching here, it brings you to yourself. It turns the focus from all that is happening around you to who you are in Christ. Amen. Like he rightly defined last week, he said, identity means who you are. Who you are. Identity means who you are. Praise God. Come on, praise God. Yeah, someone is slated to read the scriptures for us. Can you help us, please?
As soon as the meal was finished, he insisted that the disciples get in the boat and go on ahead to the other side while he dismissed the people. With the crowd dispersed, he climbed the mountain so he could be by himself and pray. He stayed there alone, late into the night. Meanwhile, the boat was far out to the sea when the wind came up against them and they were battered by the waves. At about 4 o'clock in the morning, Jesus came toward them walking on the water. They were scared out of their wits. "A ghost," they cried, crying out in terror. But Jesus was quick to comfort them. "Courage, it's me. Don't be afraid." Peter, suddenly bold, said, "Master, if it's really you, call me to come to you on the water." He said, "Come ahead." Jumping out of the boat, Peter walked on the water to Jesus. But when he looked down at the waves churning beneath his feet, he lost his nerve and started to sink. He cried, "Master, save me." Jesus didn't hesitate. He reached down and grabbed his hand. Then he said, "Faint heart. What got into you?" The two of them climbed into the boat and the wind died down. The disciples in the boat, having watched the whole thing, worshiped Jesus, saying, "This is it. You are God's son for sure."
Sure. Praise the Lord. This is it. You are God's son for sure. Heavenly Father, as we look into your word, only you can speak to our hearts. And only you can give us understanding hearts and minds. So Lord, we receive today understanding. Let the light of your word illuminate every corner of our lives. And your word that has the power to change and to transform and to cleanse and to purify and to heal and to deliver. We receive today in the name of Jesus. Father, you can also speak to our children in a language that is relevant, that you give, you have, you are the God who can do all things. And your word finds place in all our hearts. So we give you praise. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. In fact, why we go through challenges in our lives, let's start from there. Yes. Have you ever wondered, because as a Christian, I don't know how the gospel was presented to you when you came into Christ, but one of the things that some of us were made to believe was when you come into Christ, life is better. Am I right?
Amen.
Yeah, life is better.
Amen.
Yes, they say like Jesus will make your life better. Jesus will fix this for you. He forgives your sins. You will have peace of mind. You have everything, you know. I don't know whether it was presented the right way or not. But does Jesus do all this for us? Yes, he does. But in not in the format or the style that we thought he would, if you know what I mean. The most important thing that God is obsessed by is himself. If you note that down, that will help. Okay? God is obsessed with himself. If I, for lack of a better word, I hope I don't sound negative. Alright? I hope that doesn't come out negatively. But God is obsessed by him. God is When I say God is filled and full of himself, if you know what I mean, not in a negative way that we use an English word when you say somebody is full of himself, but God is full of himself because he is perfect to the core, if you know what I mean. He's the all-wise, the all-knowing, the almighty. He is the, when you talk about beauty in its essence, you're talking about God. When you talk about excellence in all its ramifications, you are talking about God. When you talk about the love that is immeasurable, that is pure and perfect, you are talking about God. When you talk about glories that are beyond descriptions, we are talking about God. In fact, no language has actually been able to capture the entirety of God's perfect and impeccable nature, if you know what I mean. Now, the Bible says when he created us, he created us exactly like himself. And then he injected into us life, something that can never be overcome. And that is his word. The first thing God did when he made you and made me was to release life into us through his word. And he said, be fruitful and multiply and subdue the earth and replenish it. That is it, period. And God sat down. Amen. Amen. Come on, amen. Amen. He made us according to his image, but he didn't just finish right there. He injected what is in him into us. Remember, the Bible says that his word is life. Am I right? His word is life. So when he speaks to you, he's releasing life into you. Amen. And the Bible says his word is light. So when he speaks to you, he's releasing light into you. Light, not this kind of light. We're talking about illumination of your intellect, understanding, insight, deep insight. I have had the privilege to chat with 2, 3, 4 people, you know, as I go out, as I stay home over the phone. Sometimes what comes out of my mouth surprises me. I wonder, did I know that? How come I didn't use it myself? You know how the wisdom of God flows out of your mouth that blesses somebody else, and then you are learning from what you just said to somebody else? Has that ever happened to you? Good, it has happened to someone. Praise God. You know what I'm saying? So in other words, the life and the light of God that was inside you is what he is allowing to flow from you, to minister or to charge up somebody else's battery, if you know what I mean. He made us in his image. Now back to what I was asking, my first question was, how come you that have faith and I that have faith go through even worse challenges than those who don't even want to associate with Christ? How come? How come? Why did God allow it? Have you ever heard somebody say, where was God when all this happened? Why didn't God take care of Satan and then everybody would be in peace all at once? Can I tell you something? God is teaching me some things that I need. If he did that, there would be no difference. Amen. This is the story of when Jesus carried a crowd of people, followed him into the wilderness to listen to his teaching. And they stayed with him for more than 2 days. I think they said they have been there for about 3 days. And they ran out of their little, you know, lunch bags, ran out, snacks, ran out. And one of the disciples said, hey, sir, these guys have been here with us for the past 3 days. They've been teaching night and day, and they are enjoying you. You are healing all of them, but they need physical food. How are we going to feed them? And they said, Jesus said, why don't you feed them? What? You know, there are some words that I've spoken, but I don't really physically. In my mind, I could hear Philip say, are you out of your mind, sir? You know what I'm saying? Even a whole day's job, the payment from a whole day's job cannot feed these people. But Jesus asked them, he said, what do you have? And as they were scrambling through their minds, one of them said, nobody has anything. Only one boy is left with a lunch bag. Jesus said, we can start with that. Bring it over. And as they
fed the 5,000. Jesus multiplied, you know the story. He took the bread, presented it to God, gave thanks, and as he was breaking the bread and the fish, distributing it among the people, 5,000 men that were counted, ate, not including women and children. Right after that, Jesus said to his disciples, hey, it is, can you guys cross the river, go to the other side? And as he went, Bible says he went up the mountain. Another translation says he went to a quiet place to pray. Went up to go and pray. That's the main thing, that's the focus. And as he was praying, listen here, this is what God was showing me. Sometimes when you are in your mess, it seems like God, when I say mess, I'm talking about the challenges we go through. When you are going through your rough end, when you are going through that dark alley, when we are going through the struggles, when we have all those questions and doubts and despair and discouragement and fear, it seems like God is far away, and it seems like you are all stuck in by yourself. Who is going to help you? What is going to happen? God is not hearing me. I can't feel him. I can't hear him. He doesn't seem to be close to me in any way. Lord, what is happening? And our minds naturally start to look around us for help. But remember, as far as Jesus was praying somewhere, he was able to sense that my boys are right striving against the storm on the sea. And what happened? Bible says he started to walk toward them. I don't know whether he finished fellowshipping with God at that time, or he just came over to respond to the needs of his men. Hello? Praise God. It's hard to know. Bible is said to be silent about that. But the thing that piqued my interest is that he came at the nick of time. He showed up when they were striving against the wind. And as soon as they saw him, they said, that's a ghost. And he said, what? He made two statements. He said, take courage. Don't be afraid. Take courage. Don't be afraid. Take courage. Don't be afraid. And suddenly, you know, we used to accuse Peter as somebody who speaks before he listens. Before he thinks, sorry. We accuse Peter, psychologists. Especially Christian psychology, Peter's character is used, you know, when you're teaching about the sanguine, temperament. The temperament that, of people that are more talkative and, you know, we use Peter often because Peter is always the first to speak. The Bible says, Peter said, sir, if that is you, ask me to come. You know, some people will say, oh, Peter, what the heck are you talking about? We're here trying to keep the boat steady, and you now want to walk on water? And somebody might say, well, this Peter must be full of himself. He always wants something special from every other person. He wants to be like the master now, so he's stepping, he wants to ask the master to come in. What kind of a proud man is that? The thing that surprised me was Jesus did not rebuke him. Jesus didn't tell him, stay right there where it is safe. Oh, come on. Jesus didn't say, Peter, what do you mean? You mean you want to be like me? He didn't say so. Peter said, Jesus, if that is you, tell me to come. And Jesus said, come on. Come on over. And Peter stepped out without thinking, but holding on to the word of the person who said, come. And the thing that marveled me was, in all this discourse, within this discourse and all that transpired, Jesus never once addressed the storm. He did not even pay attention or recognize the storm. Rather, he responded to his own son, who said, if that is you, tell me to come. You see, sometimes when you feel like you are all by yourself, and it seems like God has traveled and he's not hearing you, God has a bigger idea, a bigger picture in mind. And the Spirit of God was telling me, he said, Dita, did you remember when I said to you, there's nothing ever, as long as you are alive, that will come to you that will be beyond what you can handle? So when you feel lost in the storm, it is because you are focusing on the storm, you are not even looking at yourself, not thinking about me. Because I made you like me, you and I have the same ID. Hello? Come on, hello? As I can walk on the storm that troubled you, so you can be above the storm that is troubling you. As I have mastery over the laws of nature, the same way you have mastery over the laws of nature. But the thing is, God said to me, what are you looking at? What is your focus on? What are you filled with? What are you overwhelmed by? What are you captivated by? What are you obsessed with? What are you thinking? Are you thinking of the challenge, or are you thinking about me in you? The scripture that my sister read today says, 1 John 4:4, it says, for greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. Am I right? In other words, greater is the faith, the power of faith, greater is the Spirit of God that dwells inside Peter than the storm that surrounded him. So when Jesus said, come, Peter stepped, he exercised his faith and he stepped out, and the storm could not stop him from stepping out. As long as, come on, you read that scripture very well, you see that that Jesus did not tell the storm to quieten before Peter stepped on it. There was no mention of Jesus addressing or saying anything to the storm. And Peter did not even address the storm. The storm was still raging when Peter said, if that was you, tell me to come. And Jesus did not hesitate. He said, come. In other words, whatever it is that troubles us, is something that we can rise above depending on the choices that we make at the time. Praise the Lord. Come on, praise the Lord. Amen. Identifying with Christ means we are not just created in his image, we can do what he came.